The three structures that begin and allow the movement of food along our digestive canal, also known as the alimentary canal, are the oral cavity, also known as our mouth, the pharynx, as well as our esophagus. So let's briefly discuss what the function is and what takes place within each one of these structures. And let's begin with the oral cavity. Now, the oral cavity is also known as the mouth. And what the mouth does is initiates two important processes, one called mechanical digestion and the other one called chemical digestion. Now, mechanical digestion is the process by which we break down the large food particles into much smaller food particles. Now, mechanical digestion does not actually break down any chemical bonds. It does not break any covalent bonds that actually hold those macromolecules together. What it actually does is it simply increases the surface area of the food on which the proteolytic enzymes found in the mouth, in our stomach, and small intestine can actually act on, and this makes the process of digestion, the breakdown, much more efficient and effective. Now, what actually initiates and creates mechanical digestion is the movement of the muscles and the teeth found inside our mouth, and this is known as chewing or mastication. Now, this chewing process, the chewing of food, actually transforms our food into a spherical mass we call the bolus. And this shape of the bolus basically allows the movement of the spherical bolus along our cylinder known as our esophagus. So the esophagus, as we'll see in just a moment, is a tube that has a cylindrical shape. And the bolus, the fact that our chewing process creates this bolus is helpful because the bolus, the sphere of food, can easily move along our esophagus. Now, let's move on to chemical digestion. So, chemical digestion is the process by which our proteolytic enzymes actually break down and cleave the chemical bonds that hold our macromolecules together. So, basically, these proteolytic enzymes catalyze the reaction known as hydrolysis. It's a catabolic reaction that breaks down our chemical bonds using water. So the two types of proteolytic enzymes found in the mouth are amylase, also known as ptyalin, as well as lipase, also known as lingual lipase. Now, amylase is a proteolytic enzyme that catalyzes the breakdown of carbohydrates, specifically of starch. It breaks down our carbohydrate known as starch into our maltose as well as dextrin. On the other hand, lipase is a proteolytic enzyme that catalyzes the hydrolysis, the breakdown of fats, of lipids, into their constituents. So we see that in the mouth, we initiate the actual chemical breakdown of not only carbohydrates, but also of fats. Now, proteins are not actually broken down inside our mouth. So we increase the surface area via mechanical digestion, but we do not actually chemically digest, chemically break down our proteins in the mouth. Now, special types of glands known as salivary glands secrete a substance, a fluid known as saliva in our mouth, and saliva consists of many different things. Now, saliva consists predominantly of water. About 95% of saliva consists of water, and that's because the process of hydrolysis that is catalyzed by amylase and lipase and other protein enzymes in our stomach as well as in our small intestine require water to actually break those bonds, and that's why we have so much water in our saliva. Now, other components of saliva include these proteolytic enzymes, it includes glycoproteins, it includes mucus, it also includes special antibacterial molecules, enzymes such as lysozymes. These lysozymes basically attack and break down our cell wall, the cell walls of bacterial cells, and that kills off our bacteria. Now, what saliva also does is it actually lubricates our bolus, our food, and that allows the movement of the bolus along our esophagus with a minimal amount of friction, and that ensures that the movement of our bolus along the esophagus doesn't actually hurt. It is not actually painful. Now, let's move on to our pharynx. The pharynx is basically the passageway that connects our oral as well as nasal cavity to our windpipe as well as to our esophagus. Now, because we have this connection, this intersection between the windpipe and our esophagus, we basically have a flap of cartilage known as epiglottis that separates the windpipe from our esophagus. So what the windpipe does is it allows the movement of air from the mouth to, or from the nose or mouth to our lungs, while what our esophagus allows us to do is it allows us to actually move the food from the mouth to our stomach. Now, what this epiglottis does is when we initiate the process of swallowing, when we begin swallowing our food, our epiglottis basically closes our windpipe, and that allows our food bolus to actually move along the pharynx and right into our esophagus. So the pharynx is the passageway that connects the nasal and the oral cavity to our windpipe, our larynx, and the trachea, as well as to our esophagus. It allows not only the movement of air into and out of the lungs, but it also allows the movement of our food bolus into our esophagus. Now, in order to actually prevent the movement of the food into our windpipe, a cartilaginous flap called the epiglottis forms a protective barrier that keeps the food out of the larynx. So, as the tongue and other voluntary muscle found in the mouth initiate the process of swallowing, this reflex creates the movement of that epiglottis. And the epiglottis basically shuts closed, and that prevents the movement of our bolus into our air passageway into the larynx. Now, we have a special type of circular muscle that basically connects, that separates our esophagus as well as the pharynx. And this is known as our esophageal sphincter. And this esophageal sphincter relaxes and opens and allows the movement of that bolus into our esophagus. So now let's move on to our esophagus. So the esophagus is a relatively long and relatively narrow passageway, a cylindrical passageway that allows the movement of our bolus, the food, from the pharynx and into our stomach. So the esophagus is a relatively long and narrow passageway that connects the pharynx to our stomach. It runs along and in the back of the windpipe and is found in front of our spinal cord. Now, the upper portion of our esophagus consists of skeletal muscle, while the rest of it consists of involuntary smooth muscle. And this basically means that although we can actually initiate the process of swallowing and we can actually voluntarily control the movement of food into the upper region of the esophagus, the rest of that movement is controlled involuntarily. We cannot actually control it consciously. And this process by which our smooth muscle is found in our esophagus creates a wave-like motion and allows that bolus of food to actually travel along our esophagus is known as peristalsis. So peristalsis is the wave-like contraction of our smooth muscle that propels and allows that food to actually move down our esophagus and ultimately to our stomach. Now, once at the bottom of our esophagus, there's another sphincter known as the cardiac sphincter that actually opens up and allows the movement of that bolus from the esophagus and into our stomach. And as we'll see in the next lecture, in our stomach, we begin the digestion of our proteins.